Grace and peace be multiplied to you through the knowledge of God and our Lord Jesus Christ. Welcome. Today we'll be looking at the all-inclusive Christ in the book of Galatians. So we are looking at the book of Galatians, and today we'll be going through what the scriptures have to say, the reason why the book was written, and the goal and intention of God towards us is redeemed what was going on. And it's important to note that in the Bible, a lot of the epistles that were written to the churches was due to the fact that certain things were happening and were occurring that were really contrary to the kingdom of God, and God had to set a lot of things in place and to bring certain things to light as his expectation towards the churches. So the church in Galatia, for example, one of the issues that was taking place in that church was the Judaism, the Jewish brothers had crept into the church, and they were trying to get the Gentiles to follow the law, to keep the law, and Paul was very, very angry. He, with a holy anger, what he was even writing, even in chapter 1, he was like, if any other person should bring another gospel, even if it's to be an angel, be a cost of the law, because he had labored for these churches, and for someone to come in and start trying to bring them under the bondage of the law, it was almost like a waste to his labor. So we're going into, and it relates to us today as well as believers, all the epistles, they are starting, because Satan usually repeats his strategy. So with the same trick he used in the early church age, he keeps using it even today, and we see how it relates to us. So the book is about God's two economies or dispensation. I really hate to use the word economies, that's why it was an apostrophe. God only has one economy, but for the purpose of what we are looking at, or dispensation, the law and Christ. The law and Christ. The law was given to Moses, and Christ is actually God manifest in the flesh. So we'll be looking, and later on, as we go on, whenever you read the book, I believe that by the grace of God, the goal and the purpose of this teaching is to spur us to go back to the book to read it. So, like Galatians, maybe when we are done, or as we're reviewing it together, that you're reading it as well, and the Spirit of God will breathe more light into it. So, the law and Christ, and by nature, we are creatures of habit. God gave the law to Israel, and it was with the intention that the law was a schoolmaster until Christ would come, until faith would come, as it said in Galatians 3. But they stuck to the law. They did not even want to let go of the law. So, and after Christ had come and resurrected, now in the age of the church, the Jewish brothers were still coming to the church in Galatia, which is, I believe, predominantly Gentiles, and they were trying to tell them, hey, look, you're coming to the God of the Jews, and this is what you expect. And Christ, the Holy Spirit through Paul was trying to set things in order. So law is a lifeless religion in a bid to please God. So in the summary, yes, God gave the law, loving the Lord our God, loving our neighbors, and the Ten Commandments and what have you. But the goal was that it was going to bring us to Christ. That was a temporary measure. It was a tutor to bring us to Christ. And so law is a lifeless religion in a bid to please God. Christ is a living relationship with God. So just trying to define, at least in a summary, what the law is, it's more or less trying to please God in our human flesh, in our self. And God says, by flesh shall no man be justified. And God said, the just shall live by faith. God said, not by power, not by might, but by my spirit, says the Lord. God's intention is that we should not do anything, believers, to him without having the Spirit as the very essence of what we are doing. It should not be that in my flesh, because I have my human will, you have your human will, and God is like, look, those have been crushed on the cross of Calvary. It is corrupt before me, because when Adam sinned, the whole human nature was corrupted. So we could do good in ourselves, but it is unacceptable to God if it is not with Christ we are doing such. So going ahead as well, the next slide, the law relates to the old covenant, why Christ relates to the new covenant. And in Galatians chapter 4, Paul was making two allegories about how Abraham had two sons, and the first son, Ishmael, was the son of a bond woman, and the promise is Isaac, that's the second son, who is actually the promise, of course, he's supposed to be the one, picturizing Christ. Isaac is a type of Christ. So the law relates to the old covenant, which basically the reason God gave them the law, so that transgression, because man probably believed that he can please God, he can do everything God expects him to do without the assistance of God. So part of maybe one of the reasons God gave the law to man, okay, let me see how you're going to do it. And they really tried to keep everything in the law. Some of them were very zealous at it, but there was one part in that law that really, no matter how much you've kept everything, this one was so hard for any human nature. That one that says that you shall not covet, that's hard. That's not really external, it's internal. And as human nature, the fallen human nature, we cannot help but covet certain things. But this is in Romans 7, where Paul was lamenting about the good he wishes to do. He doesn't have the will to do it, and the evil he doesn't want to do seems that it appears the flesh is gravitating towards that. So Christ relates to the new covenant. Religion is the act of doing things for God without the presence of Christ. So whether it is giving, whether it is praying, I mean, Muslims pray, there are some religions in the world. I don't think Christianity is a religion. A religion, in my own definition, is just rituals that people are doing in a bid to appease God in the absence of Christ. Christianity, then, what is Christianity? It's a living relationship with God. It's a living relationship with God. So religion is opposed to Christ. And so here in the book of Galatians, they were involved in a lot of things, even in the worship of moon, trying to keep the Sabbath, and it was a whole lot of things, and Paul wasn't very happy with what was going on. It was like, heavens began in the spirit, do you think you'll be perfected in the flesh? And he kept on writing this, showing the two sides of the law and Christ, of the flesh and of the spirit. So in chapter 1, Christ is revealed in us. So there's a problem, or there was a problem in the church in Galatia and in Galati, and there's still a problem as well. I believe it's very relevant to us in our day and age, and because the enemy is still the same, repeating the old cycle. So here was Paul now coming to say that, hey, get this clear in your mind, that in the old creation in Adam, you died to the law. Now you are in Christ. So in Galatians chapter 1, a very key thing he said in that, from verse 15 and 16, if I could read that, was about God, when he pleased God to reveal his son in us. And I believe it's a prayer for every one of us as well, that God's intention is, and this is not a one-time revelation, it's a continuous revelation. So let's not think that once we know the Son of God is in us, that's it. There is so much, it's boundless, it's unsearchable. So every moment, every day, we need fresh revelation of the Lord Jesus Christ. So in Galatians 1:15 says, but when he pleased God, who separated me from my mother's womb and called me through his grace to reveal his son in me, that I might preach him among the Gentiles. So we can see there, here was Paul saying that when it pleased God, who separated him from his mother's womb to reveal his son in us. So it pleased God, it is God's good pleasure to reveal his son in us, because we can't live the Christian life except Christ is living it in our life. We are just a vessel, we are just this earthen vessel carrying this treasure of Christ, having this treasure of Christ in us. It's almost like expecting a computer hardware to function without any software to power it. Pardon my analogy of using Christ to us in form of a software and a computer, but something we can relate with. So God's goal is that nothing in our life, said all our righteousness is filthy rags before him. So God realizes the fact that as Christians, his intention is that our life should epitomize Christ. We should be a living epistle of Christ. The first thing he did was to reveal his son in Paul and us as well. He said that he might preach him. I could use that word preach to mean that he might minister him. So no matter any walk of life you are in, I'm in, whether as a musician, a gospel artist, a sports star, a politician, a pastor, in the ministry, in any, everything is ministry unto the Lord. We say we should do everything unto the Lord. But God's intention is that we have to minister Christ. Those are just platforms. They are just camouflage, those things we are doing, so that Christ could be released into the hearts of men. So God must reveal Christ continually in our life. And in chapter 2, he now went further to talk about Christ living in us. And earlier on in chapter 2, he mentioned about, of course, the little scoff between Peter and Paul, and of course Peter trying to he knew better, and Paul wasn't happy with that. Why are you trying to live like the Gentiles when you know, why are you trying to live like the Jew when you know that we've been dead to the law? And here among the Gentiles, of course, some Jewish brothers came in and Peter withdrew, and Paul saw the hypocrisy, that no, this will not help the work of the gospel. And later on he now said that he has been crucified with Christ, that nevertheless he lives, this is not him that lives, but Christ lives in him. So we can see how important to it. And it was like, if if he's going to live by the law, then Christ died in vain. The grace of God will be in vain over his life. Then in chapter 3, of course, in chapter 3, he started with the fact of the Spirit, that we have received the Spirit, and having received the Spirit, are we now made perfect in the? Are we now made perfect through the law? And he now gave the exposition on how Abraham as well, that he said the just shall live by faith, that God gave the promise to Abraham by faith, and as many that believe, like having the faith of Abraham, they are the seed of Abraham. And he went further to now say that Christ has redeemed us from the curse of the law. He said anyone who keeps the law must do everything. You can't do 9/10. There's no such thing as 90%. If you fail in one, you failed in everything. And so here is he now trying to get us out of that bondage of the law, because he said if you remain in that bondage of the law, the curse of the law will be on you. But Christ fulfilled the law, and so that he will be the very essence of our living. And later on, he now started mentioning about the fact that we are sons of God through faith in Christ Jesus, that haven't been baptized into Christ, we have put on Christ. And what a joy. And in chapter 4, of course, he now went for, he said that in chapter 3, towards the latter side of chapter 3, that look, you have been brought away from the law, that we should, the law was a tutor, was like a school, like a housemaid, if we use our modern day and time, just sometimes, you know, some parts of the world, housemaid could be engaged to look after kids at a very young age. And at that period, they are supposed to outgrow. Once they get to a certain age, they don't need a housemaid to be telling them what to do, when to sleep, because by natural instinct, as they mature, they should know better when to eat, when to go to the restroom, when to sit down, what have you. So here was Paul now saying that that was the essence why God gave the law to man, just to bring us until faith will come, that is until Christ, who is the author and finisher of our faith. So in chapter 4, he now said that look, and here, as long as he remains a child, doesn't differ from a slave, though he be Lord over all. It was a charge to make us grow spiritually, that we should not remain at the baby state, that until the Father's appointed time, that the goal of the law was to bring us to Christ, so that we outgrow that peace, that pattern. Later on in chapter 4, he now went on to talk about the fact of the two covenants, about how Abraham had two sons, and the first was the son of a bondwoman, the second is the son of the free. And that in chapter 5, he went on to tell us about the liberty that we should stand in, the liberty that Christ has redeemed us before he went to the work of the flesh and the work of the Spirit. So these are the fruit of this, the work of the flesh, and we should walk in the Spirit. And as again, that if we walk in the Spirit, we will not fulfill the lust of the flesh and the evidences of the work of the flesh and the fruits of the Spirit. So the central theme of the book is the promised Spirit as the blessing of the gospel. Somebody might ask, what's the promised Spirit? The promised Spirit is not just one third of God. It's not, sometimes we think that the Spirit of God is just one third of God, and we've done few video lessons in the past before on this, so we looked at it in detail. So if you would, if you could, you could visit our YouTube channel, The All-Inclusive Christ, and there's one Christ as Christ as the Spirit as revealed in the New Testament, also becoming one Spirit with the Lord. There are a few of them, and the Resurrection Ministry of Christ as well, where we looked at the fact that the Spirit of God is not just one third of God, but it is God passing through the process. So it includes the divinity of God, it includes the humanity through the Lord Jesus Christ in his incarnation, it includes his death and his resurrection. This was the Spirit that was not yet in John 7:37-39, because Jesus was yet to be crucified. The Spirit that God wanted to live in his believers, in his children, in the what he promised Abraham, was the Spirit of the resurrected Son of God, which we will see in Galatians 4:6, that God has sent forth the Spirit of his Son into our hearts, crying out, Abba, Father. And someone might say, how do you mean, is this Spirit different from the Holy Spirit? 1 John 5:7 says that 1 John 5:7, there are three that bear records in heaven, the Father, the Word, and the Holy Ghost. These three are one. The Word of God says they are one. 2 Corinthians 3:17, the scriptures say, now the Lord is the Spirit. Also in Revelation 2:3, the Lord Jesus Christ calls himself the Spirit seven times. So it's a mystery. It's because we're trying to divide them. The Lord actually became the Spirit upon his resurrection. But if you could take time to watch the video, we looked at a lot of the scriptures that what scriptures give to us that lay credence to us. So from Christ in chapters 1 and 2 to the Spirit in chapter 3, now the Lord is the Spirit. So we hear Paul using the term Christ, or the Holy Spirit using the term Christ in Galatians 1, Galatians 2. We get into chapter 3, now the Spirit comes in place. It appears, is this a baton or a relay? No, it's because it's the same person. The Lord is the Spirit. The Lord is the Spirit. He said in 1 Corinthians 6:17 that he who is joined to the Lord is one spirit with him. And the Lord Jesus Christ called himself the Spirit 7 times. We dare not say he's not the Spirit. The Trinity are one. Essentially, they are one. Economically, they are three. It's because we are trying to, in the past, we've thought that there are three separate God. And God has said all through scriptures, I think even in Galatians chapter 3, verse 20, he said that, but God is one. Deuteronomy 6:4. Here, O Israel, the Lord your God is one. Isaiah 45:5 said that, I am the Lord your God. Beside me, there is no God. So God is one. God is one. We see it all through scripture, but we have him as a Father, as a Son, and as a Spirit. So now the Lord is the Spirit. So looking ahead, no longer I, but Christ lives in me. So God's intention is like, let's not try to do good in ourselves, because that will be the law. That will be trying to please God with the human flesh, with the human will. And God, the human flesh or the human will is an abomination in the sight of God, trying to do good. That's why I said all our righteousness are filled with rags before him. He wants the very essence of our being, my speaking, my eating. He said all we do it in the name of the law. So God doesn't desire we do anything. He said, without me, you can do nothing. God doesn't desire we do anything except by his Son, by the Lord Jesus Christ, who is also not one third of the Godhead. He is the embodiment of the Godhead. So he's the embodiment of the Father. He said, I am in the Father and the Father is in me, in John 14. So when we look at Christ, let's not think that is just one third of the Godhead. It's just the embodiment of the Godhead. So God could say Christ is, God saying Christ lives in me means that God is living in me. God is living in you as a believer, because scripture tells us that the Father is living in us, the Son is living in us, and the Spirit is living in us. But we don't have three people living in us, because it's a greater is he that is in us than he that is in the world. It's because the three are one. In Galatians chapter 1, the last verse, he said, Paul said that they glorify God in me. And in chapter 2, he said, Christ lives in me. And by the time we go later on, it's going to be the Spirit is one living in us. So we think there are three different God's living in us. No, it's because the three are one. 1 John 5:7, and also John 10:30, the Lord Jesus Christ said, I and the Father are one. He also said that he that has seen me has seen the Father. If you know me, you have known the Father. Stop, invariably was saying, stop asking for the Father outside of me. There's no Father outside of me, because he's saying that he is the embodiment of the Godhead. Isaiah 9:6 calls him the Father. Unto us a child is born, a son is given, the government shall be upon his shoulder, his name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, and the Prince of Peace. So you could imagine, is the mystery of God, is a mystery and a very mystery. So it's not a matter of keeping the law, but of Christ living in us. Christ living in us. That's God's intention and God's goal. The book tells us that we have been baptized into Christ. So being baptized into Christ doesn't mean we are baptized into one third of the Godhead, because Christ is the embodiment of the Godhead. And it will really help us. For me personally, it really helped me, as the Lord helped me opening my eyes through a lot of materials from the church, early centuries of the church fathers, and a lot of materials, Andrew Murray, Witness Lee, Watchman Lee. I mean, a lot of their materials, and I'm sure there are other vessels as well God has used to open our eyes to this grace mystery, that Christ is not just one third of the Godhead. Christ is the embodiment. So in certain places, we are told we are baptized into the Father. Of course, in Matthew 28:19, baptizing them into the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. And we also told in John chapter 1 that the Lord Jesus Christ will baptize, he's the one that baptized in the Holy Ghost. And here in chapter 3 of Galatians, he's saying that we are baptized into Christ. Do we have three baptisms? My opinion is like, I don't think we have three baptisms. Why do I say that? Ephesians chapter 4 tells us that we have one baptism, that we have one body, one spirit, that it's one Lord, one hope of our calling, one baptism. We only have one Father, one God, and one God, one Father, who is above all, through all, and in you. So we only have one baptism. So to be baptized into Christ is to be baptized into the Father, the Son, and the Spirit, because Christ is the embodiment of the Godhead. In him dwells the fullness of the Godhead, Colossians chapter 2, verse 9. So being baptized into Christ is to be immersed in the divine Trinity. That is like, it's we learned that the Greek word for baptism, it's almost like when you take a donut and you put it in a cup of tea, that the donut is soaked, the very being of that donut is soaked with every, the elements of the tea has gotten inside that. That's what it means for much more than it will mean that, but that's just an example. That's what it, for us to be baptized into Christ, that's every part of our being. Christ becomes our sphere, and our element, our sphere, is that a realm we live in, and our element as the very element of our life, just like juice is the element of an orange, or gold is the element of a golden cup. So Christ becomes our very element. So baptism means to be put into something. For as many as been baptized into Christ have put on Christ. So wherever we go, we are the living epistles of Christ. Men should see Christ. We carry the aroma and the presence of Christ into every environment we appear. God's intention was to use the law to bring us to Christ. So God's intention from that Galatians 3 was to use the law, the law was a tutor to bring us to Christ. But of course, he needed first of all to give the law so that transgression could come. Because man would believe that there's no evil or no bad thing in him. Still going through after the tree of knowledge of good and evil. But God's intention is to bring out the evil. Not, he didn't give it to punish man, but I believe that, in my own opinion, that I believe it, that he gave the law to man so that man will see his helplessness without a deliverer. So that man will cry out that, Lord, this is just too much for us. Please send the Savior, send the deliverer to deliver us from this bondage. And so we can see that God's intention was to use the law to bring us to Christ. He said that in Galatians 3, the closing side, and also in Galatians 4 as well. It was the goal of the law was to bring, the law was a tutor. Is you don't put your children to have, you don't put them under a housemate forever. No, it's only a certain age. When they know better, when they grow and they mature and they are eating right, of course, they with their senses and every part of their being. That's why it's very important for us as Christians to feed our spirit man. And I think in Hebrews chapter 4, it said that strong meat belongs to those who have exercised their senses to discern between good and evil. So God's goal was to bring us to Christ, but the law was the medium to do that for us. To get us out of religion or the law, God has to first reveal Christ in us, Galatians 1, then he begins to live in us, Galatians 2, and he be formed in us, Galatians 4:19, that Paul said that my little children to whom I travel until Christ be formed in you, and so that will be formed more and more in us. There's no end to him being formed. Just like I said, that the revelation of Christ is not a one-time experience, is not a one-time thing, because it's so boundless. There are so many aspects of the Lord Jesus Christ we don't even have a clue that it is. But God has to continue to reveal him, to reveal every part of him, even from the Old Testament, because it was in the Old Testament in types and shadows and prefigures. And by the grace of God, by the mercy of God, he will teach us himself. By the grace of God, we believe that one of these days we do a video lesson of the prefiguration of Christ. That is looking at the Old Testament, looking at the types, the shadows, a lot. I don't think one video lesson will do it, but the Lord will help us as well. So he has to continue to reveal Christ to us in different aspects. Then as well, now so that Christ will be living in us and he will be formed in us more and more. To have Christ formed in us, we must take him as our indwelling person. So we must be aware, as through his revelation, as God, it pleases God to reveal his more of his son in us, then what happens is that we'll be conscious of his indwelling presence. We'll be conscious of the spirit of the Son of God abiding in us. So before we take any step, any decision, before we'll say anything, before we minister, before we go out in our regular place or walk in the marketplace, we will be like, God, no longer I but Christ, no longer I but Christ, no longer I but you. Lord, be one spirit with me. As I'm speaking, let it be you speaking through me. Lord, my thoughts, my actions, my utterance, every part of my being, let it be to the glory of your name. Let it be by your spirit that I am doing everything I'm doing. So that will saturate every part of us. Ephesians 3 talks about the fact that we may be strengthened with might by his spirit in our inner man, that Christ will make his home in us. So what a joy. Then he will saturate every part of our being with himself. This means we must stop all our choosing, thinking, liking, and turn to the indwelling Christ. Everything. God doesn't expect that me, I should be the husband at home or as the father at home, or you should be the father, the husband, the wife, the boss at work, or the subordinate, or the superior, the CEO, the lawmaker, the musician, the gospel artist, the drama minister, the technical director, in the White House, in any walk of life God has called you, or even if it's a soccer player or a sports star, God's intention is that you should not be the one living. He says, let my son be the one living through you. So God himself is in Christ. 2 Corinthians 5, God was in Christ reconciling the world to himself. So God's intention is God, because Christ is the means and channel through everything God will do regarding man. So God's intention is like nobody can please him except Christ. He's the only offering is the son that he has pleasure in. So his goal is now, he has brought us into the realm, into the sphere of Christ, and has also made Christ our element, so that every part of our being, we minister Christ everywhere we go. So it's not a question of trying to be a good husband or good wife, or trying to be a good parent or what have you. Yes, those are ethical. Even the Muslims, the Buddhists, and other religions, dead religions of this world, they don't teach their followers to do evil to their fellow men. I believe most of them, we tell them to do good. Most of them, we tell them things that are ethics in nature, to be nice, to be good, to give alms. But Christianity is far more than that. Christianity is that let Christ be the one living through us. There's no religion in the world that whoever they claim to be worshipping is living in them. We are the only ones that have that exclusive right as children of God by sheer mercy, that God has chosen us as his vessel to live through us. He said, it is God who works in you both to will and to do for his good pleasure, from Philippians 2:13, and also Hebrews 13:20, 21. Now the God of peace make you perfect in every good work, working in you that which is well-pleasing in sight through Christ Jesus. I like to pray that prayer every day, that Lord, please make me perfect in every good work, working in me that which is well-pleasing in your sight through Christ Jesus. Also, by chapter 5, Paul tells us that if we are still in religion, Christ will profit us nothing. Because Christ is like, I have nothing to do with the religion. Don't even bring me towards that. If you want me to live in you, then be dead to the law. Let it be me to be the law of Christ. Because I think in chapter 6, he now talks about the law of Christ, that we should serve one another. Because yes, we want to do good. Don't get me wrong, I'm not saying it's bad to do good. But in the eyes of God, he doesn't want us to do any good without Christ being the one doing the good. I had this experience some time ago. It's a few years back, was in the church, and we do outreach in our church. And one way or the other, we have this certain brother that normally comes from the neighborhood. And usually we would give out food, sometimes in my come, and that they need groceries, because we do almost every other week we do give out free groceries to the neighborhood. And sometimes I will feel in my spirit not to give this particular, because we have certain days we do give out the distributions, but sometimes during the week they could stop by, and I felt in my spirit not to give to this person because he keeps coming back. But I just, in my mind, I'm like, I didn't know better. I was just like, but it's going to be wrong for somebody to come ask for food and we have groceries. I mean, why shouldn't we give in to him as a church? But I didn't feel led to. Sometimes something in me, I believe was the Spirit of God, will hold me back. But yet I will still, carry out that it's good to do good. I was doing good. But later on, in a short while, we now got to hear that this particular brother was not really in need, but he was using those food that we were giving out in the measure of in good faith. He was actually using it, intentionally selling it outside. I didn't know that. He was selling it to other people. So you could imagine that sometimes we want to do good, but God knows better. So whatever good I want to do, God says, let it be Christ in me, giving me the green signal to go. So I'm not saying don't do good. Galatians 6 ended that we should do good to all men, especially to those of the household of faith. But God is saying, who is the source of the good you are doing? Is it the flesh, or is it Christ as the Spirit in your heart? That's the question, and I pray that God will help us to be more attuned to the leading of the Spirit of God. So Christ, Galatians is focused on the indwelling Christ. The indwelling Christ and the Spirit are one. They are not two separate beings, like I mentioned, because the scriptures say now the Lord is the Spirit. So from Christ to the Spirit, the first two chapters was pretty much about Christ. Then he now went to using the term the Spirit. So when it relates to the substitutionary work of the Lord on the cross of Calvary, the terminology that Paul used more often was Christ. Then when it comes to our living day to day, it's hard to divide it. They are one. The scripture leaves it as one, but of course in some terminologies it might say the Spirit of the Son of God, the Spirit of life, for example in Romans chapter 9, in Romans chapter 8 verse 2, and in the Spirit of Jesus Christ, Acts 6:6-7, the Holy Spirit, the Spirit of God, the Spirit of grace, the Spirit of Christ, Romans chapter 8, 9-11. So you can see the interchangeableness. It's because it's just one Spirit, because Ephesians chapter 4 verse 4 say there's one body, there's one Spirit. We don't have two different spirits. We don't have the Holy Spirit and the Spirit of Jesus Christ, because the last Adam, 1 Corinthians 15:45b, became a life-giving Spirit, a Spirit that gives life. Paul talks about the Spirit Christ in the first part of, then he shifts to the Spirit from chapter 3, because he became a Spirit upon his resurrection, the Lord Jesus Christ. We should not consider Christ and and the Spirit as two separate beings. And Galatians 4 verse 6 just nailed it when the scripture says that God has sent forth the Spirit of His Son into our heart, crying out, Abba, Father. So whatever has been accomplished on the cross, it appears Paul uses the term Christ. But when Christ is experienced by us in our spirit, Paul uses the title the Spirit. Or else we could say Galatians 2, it says that Christ lives in me. So if Christ is living in us, the Spirit of God is living in us. The Father is living in us. The scripture says, 1 John 5:7, the three are one. It's a mystery, the three one God or the one three God. We just believe it. It's hard for our human language to be able to reconcile, to be able to put a division. Let's not even try it. They are distinct, but they are inseparable. They are one. So let's just leave it as it is, as the scriptures has given us. But he that is joined to the Lord is one spirit. 1 Corinthians 6:17. Now the Lord is the Spirit. God has no intention of giving us anything but Himself. So God's greatest gift to us is Himself. As believers in Christ Jesus, said that you are sons of God through faith in Christ Jesus. So what God promised to Abraham in that Genesis 12 and also in Galatians chapter 3 is that the promised Spirit is actually God Himself that has passed through the process of incarnation, God manifest in the flesh, human living, the four gospels, the crucifixion, and the resurrection. Now we now have the consummation of God. That is God passing through the process to become a spirit that gives life. God will not say in 1 Corinthians 15:45 that the last Adam became a life-giving spirit. That means he was not a life-giving spirit before his resurrection. And if you read 1 Corinthians 15, the whole of 15, you find that before that 45, he kept on building. The Holy Spirit was building, it was kind of building the ground for that 45, because he said, what you sow in corruption, you reap in glory. So he became a spirit that gives life. God is spirit, John 4:24, but it was not a spirit that gives life until Jesus went to the cross to die. Because he said in John 12:24, that except a grain of wheat fall to the ground and die, it abides by itself. So God became Christ, God became man in the person of the Lord Jesus Christ, went through death to become the grain of wheat sown, and now resurrected as a life-giving spirit, as a spirit that gives life. Hence, he could give us life. His goal is to give us life. He made us in his image and likeness in Genesis chapter 1, but his goal was that we should not just be in his image and likeness, but we should also have his life. So you can have a toy and a living baby. They are in the image, both of them in the image of a man, a human, but one has the life of a human, the other doesn't have a life of. So God's goal is, that's why he said in John 10, I have come that they may have life. His goal is that we should not just be in the image and likeness of God, but we should also have his life in us. And hence we have the last Adam became a life-giving spirit, the spirit that gives life. So what a great joy. Well, Galatians tells us that we are one with Christ and he's one with us. So Galatians is bringing up the fact that we are not just by ourselves, that we are now in union with the Lord Jesus Christ through our faith in him, because God's Son is being revealed in us by the Father. He's living inside of us. We have been baptized into him and he's being formed in us. So there's an organic union between we and Christ. So the book is telling us we are one with Christ and he's one with us. And he first came into our dead in spirit to make it alive, to regenerate us in the spirit. Then he remains in our spirit as the Spirit of the Son of God. So his first coming was to regenerate our spirit in regeneration, and now he remains there as the Spirit of the Son of God. And this time we'll see in Galatians 4 verse 6. So you can see the two sides, that God's goal is that we are one with the Lord Jesus Christ, but for that to be, the Lord had to become a man. He had to live as a man, die as a man, now resurrect as a life-giving spirit to live in our hearts. What a joy for what the Lord has done for us. Also, Galatians tells us we should not care for the law that is trying to do good in our fleshly self. Rather, we should be dead to the law. That is the law. Now we have a new law, which is the law of Christ, whereby we carry each other, we love our neighbors as ourselves, we walk in the spirit. I think the summary of the law of Christ, in my opinion, is just walk in the spirit. And that in this spirit of the Son of God, everything we do, we are being led by the Spirit, because he knows better than us. He knows better than us. God's intention and pleasure are to reveal Christ in us, in chapter 1. that Christ to live in us, chapter 2, for Christ to be formed in us and wrought into every part of our being from chapter 4, and for us to be clothed with Christ, and also for us to have the liberty in Christ from chapter 5 as well. And chapter 6, he said, therefore I bear in my body the marks of the Lord Jesus Christ, let no man trouble me. And he said, we should sow to the Spirit, which we will also see later on. This is a matter of dealing not with good, but with Christ. So it's not a function of, am I doing good in my family to my neighbor? God's good. Please don't misinterpret this. God is not saying don't do good. God is saying that because the hidden of this was they do good, and even Satan himself can do good. God called it, there were two trees in Genesis 2, the tree of life or the tree of knowledge of good and evil. God says, eat of the tree of life. God didn't say the tree of evil alone, but the tree of knowledge of good and evil, because Satan himself could use the good we are trying to do as a bait to make us to do certain things that will be contrary to God. For example, he came to our Lord Jesus Christ. He told him to do something, turn the stone to bread. You know, you could, maybe you're in a crusade or somewhere, there's need in a particular place where you are in, and some kind of demonic spirit, they turn this stone to bread. But Jesus said, no, man shall not live by bread, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. And he said in John 6:3, these words have spoken unto their spirits and their life. So God's intention is not that we do good. He even told Jesus to jump from the cliff, so that he was quoting Psalm 91. But he said no, because he knew that the good, no matter good Satan is trying to tell, is a bait to make us to do something contrary to the will of God. So God is looking at it, whatever good I'm doing or you're doing or we're doing in any way, God's goal is like, who is the source of that good we're doing? Is it the flesh or is it Christ that is the source? And that's where we now come to the fact that let him be the one living through us and not we. The Spirit of the Son of God in us should be allowed to live through us henceforth. So it should be the very essence of our being. It should be the very element of everything we are going to do. So for us to live is Christ. That should be our motto, Philippians chapter 1, that because in him we live, we move, and have our being. No longer I, but Christ. No longer I, but Christ. I have this in my closet each morning. I cannot help but see that, Lord, as I go out today, no longer I but Christ. When people see me, may they see you. When people shake my hands, let it be you they are shaking. When people come to ask me for anything, let them rip you from my life. Let it not be about me, because I've been crucified. A dead person is dead, but it's just mysterious that this dead person is still mobile and moving around. So to be conscious of the fact that we've been crucified with Christ, it is no longer our us we live, but Christ who lives in us as believers in Christ Jesus. That should be our motto in everything we do. The book thus admonishes us to walk in the Spirit. So in this promised Spirit, is the consummation of the God, that's the Father, the Son, and the Spirit. It says we should have our being in the Spirit. We should be led of the Spirit in chapter 5. We should live in the Spirit. We should sow to the Spirit. So you can see that every part of our being should be by the Spirit. In other parts of the epistle say we should be fervent in the Spirit. I mean, it's everywhere. We should rejoice in the Spirit. We should be filled with the Spirit. Ephesians 5:18. So every part of our living as Christians is that to walk in the Spirit. Then we will not fulfill the lust of the flesh. So as Christians, God's goal for us is not that, okay, don't steal, don't backbite, don't fornicate, he's not really so much. That's not the goal for him. His goal is that walk in the Spirit. If you walk in the Spirit, you are led of the Spirit, the Spirit of the Son of God, you will not fulfill the lust of the flesh. And the Muslims and the other religions will tell you, they will be giving excuses, don't do this, don't do that, don't do that. Yes, God admonishes us in the Bible not to do a lot of things, but you can see that they weren't the priority in each of those epistles. It was later on, because they are still babes. There are a lot of people still drinking milk. There are a lot of carnal people, maybe we want to say carnal believers. So God's intention, he still has to come to their level to say, don't do this, don't steal, don't kill. But God expects those that are matured, and as we are maturing, that's why I say, and here, as long as he remains a baby, child, Galatians 4:1, that he, though he be Lord of all, will not be different from a slave. God's intention is that we outgrow and we grow spiritually. But for that to happen, we have to give him space for the Son to be revealed in us. And how will his Son be living in us is to the measure his word is dwelling in us, because the Lord and his word, they are one. He said, let the word of Christ dwell in you richly, from Colossians 3:16. Also in Galatians, the law is versus Christ and the flesh is versus the Spirit. Also, the law is always related to the flesh, and Christ is always related to the Spirit. The two are always at war. It's a battle every day almost as many times in the day, the battle between the flesh and the spirit, everyone born of a woman. So as believers, we are not exempted from that. It doesn't mean that some of the flesh, what the flesh will ask us to do is evil. Because as we grow in the law, we will probably know, we don't even need to ask God. Some things are outright sin in ourselves. We don't want to say, no, this is outright. I'm going to lie in this case. But some things are gray area where the flesh could want to use to creep in. But God is now. So there's a battle between the flesh and the spirit every day. And I believe who is going to emerge winner in these two battle or warfare, I think it's to what you fed. If you fed your flesh more through a lot of junks and toxic materials we've allowed our eyes to see and our ears to hear, of course that flesh is just going to manifest himself. But if we feed the spirit, he said that do not be more that God is not mocked. Whatever a man sow, he will reap. I believe he was talking much more. If you sow to the spirit, he said you will reap everlasting life. If you sow to the flesh, you reap corruption in Galatians 6. So God is saying that sow to the spirit. How do you sow to the spirit? Let the word of God dwell in your heart richly, because the word of God is food, it is a drink, it's wine that intoxicates in a holy way. It's Ephesians 5:18 says, don't be drunken with wine, but be filled with the Spirit. It says, the word I've spoken unto you, they are spirit and they are life. Ezekiel 2:2 says, the Spirit entered me in when he spoke unto me. So the more of the word of God that is coming into our life, the more the Spirit of God and the Spirit of the Son of God will be able to power our will for us to cooperate with the doings of the Lord in our life. Else we'll just be helpless, because if we don't sow the seed of the word of God, more of the word of God into our life, allowing our eyes and our ears to feed on the word of God. It told Joshua in Joshua chapter 1 that in this book shall you meditate day and night, so that you make your way successful. So it's a battle that is going on every day, and that battle is won by who we are fed. So have we fed the flesh, or have we fed the spirit? God said God is not mocked. Whatever a man sow, he will reap. If you sow to the flesh, you reap corruption. If you sow to the spirit, you reap life everlasting. The law is always related to the flesh. Christ is always related to the spirit. The two are always at war. Also, the five main items in Galatians are the law, the flesh, Christ, the spirit, and the cross. Those are the busy, and of course, the cross is to crucify the flesh and the law. So the law and the flesh have been dealt with on the cross. Daily, we still carry our cross. There's no, the cross, Christ on the cross of Calvary has paid the price. But daily, that's why I said that I have been crucified with Christ. So cross is, in a sense, God is telling us that we bear our cross. That is like the flesh is still trying to rear its ugly head, but we are dead to the law. That is, we can't allow ourselves, because the cross and the flesh, they are not friends. So in every situation, the cross, we come in, we take the power of the blood, so that we have the enablement and the power to do what? To outdo or to overpower the desires and the lust of the flesh. And how do we do that? By walking in the Spirit. Now we have Christ as the Spirit. Thus we should walk and live in the Spirit. There's no way to be able to be able to overcome the flesh except we are walking in the Spirit, and Christ is empowering us day and night. So here's Galatians 4, verse 4 to 5 and 6. But when the fullness of time was come, God sent forth his Son, made of a woman, made under the law, to redeem them that were under the law, that we might receive the sonship. It's interesting that God sent forth his Son, and it's good for sending the Son that we might receive the sonship. So you could imagine God wanted to make us sons, and that's why I said in Galatians 3, you are all sons of God through faith in Christ Jesus, and also that we have been baptized into Christ, and we have put on, those of us baptized, that we have put on Christ. And in 1 John 3 also say, behold what manner of love, that we should be called the children of God. This is for our judicial redemption. That is what Christ did on the cross of Calvary, the paperwork of our salvation. So our salvation is in twofold. There's a judicial redemption, which is Christ dying on the cross for us to pay the price for our sin, to reconcile us to God, to justify us. The second aspect is now the organic salvation, which is Christ living in our heart to transform, to regenerate us, to sanctify us, to renew us, to transform us. Because why do we need God's organic salvation? Is because we are coming from Adam. We are coming from Egypt to Canaan land, and God needs to keep purging every element of Egypt away from our life. That is not a one-time experience. That is a daily experience. Hence, we have his Spirit in us, sanctifying us every day, working in us both to will and to do for his good pleasure, to conform us to the image of the Son of the living God. And this is Galatians 4:6. And because you are son, God has sent forth the Spirit of his Son into your heart, crying, Abba, Father. This is for our organic salvation. God's Spirit with our spirit. That is what is called the organic salvation. that is God living inside of us to carry out his intention through our life. He didn't die on the cross for us to just stay on the earth and wait until he comes back at the rapture for us to meet him in the air. Somehow that we are just earthly useless because we are waiting for him to come from heaven. God's goal is that he saved us so that our light will shine before men. They may see our good work and glorify our Father in heaven. God's intention, he saved us so that we will be his vessel. He will live inside of us and carry out his purposes and plans here on earth. And when our assignment is done here on earth, we join him in glory in the heavens and in the new Jerusalem. So you can see how important God's organic salvation is. I believe this is the reason why the churches were set up in any church of the living God where you are. Where God's goal is that the pastors are feeding us with the word of God, because that is what causes an organic change in our life. The more the word of God is coming in us, the more the spirit of God will be mingled with our human spirit, and the more it will saturate our mind, our soul. You say, to be carnally minded is death, but to be spiritually minded is life and peace in Romans chapter 8. So you can see how important the organic salvation is, and what a joy for that. And in summary of what we've done in Galatians 2:20, I have been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live, but Christ lives in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith in the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. So you can see that as Christians, what makes us believers is just that Christ is living in us. Another person is living in us, working his good pleasure through our life, because we are his masterpiece. We are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus unto good work. So in summary, we've been able to look at the book of Galatians today, the all-inclusive Christ in the book of Galatians. We said that the church had a lot of issues, the church in Galatia, which we could say represents a lot of issues we could say now day and age are still relevant as well. They went after Judaism, they went after trying to keep the law, and Paul was not happy at all in chapter 1. He said, if any other person preaches another gospel to them apart from the one he has preached to them, it should be a cause of the law. But the key part in chapter 1 was that God revealed, when he pleased God to reveal his Son in Paul, and that's God's goal and intention for you and I, believers in Christ Jesus. Every day he plans to reveal more of his Son. In Romans chapter 10, he says that how will they call upon him who they've not had. So the Lord is rich unto all that call upon him. So, but how will they call upon him who they've not had? And how will they hear without a preacher? And how will they preach except they be sent? And I'll say, how beautiful are them that preach the gospel of the good news. So you can see God needs to keep revealing his Son, and we have to be open to the revelation of the Son of God in our life. The more his Son is revealing us, the more we are able to minister him, to preach him in any platform God has given to us. By chapter 2, it talks about that Christ, that the law is against Christ. Christ is not for the law. Christ wants to live in us. The law was crucified on the cross of Christ, on the cross of Calvary, so that Christ will be living inside of our heart. The new law is the law of Christ. And the law of Christ, I believe in my opinion, is for us to walk in the Spirit. If we walk in the Spirit, all those laws in the Old Testament will fulfill it effortlessly, because it will not be us doing the work, but the Son of the living God is Spirit doing it through us. By chapter 3, it moved on to the fact that the Galatian church, that they started in the Spirit, why have they moved to the flesh? That there's a problem there, that it is God that does miracles among you. Does he do it by the work of the law or by the hearing of faith or by the Spirit? So, and he talked about the fact that Christ has redeemed us from the curse of the law. That curse is everyone that hanged upon the tree, that he did it so that the blessing of Abraham will come upon us who have believed and who have had faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. So that this blessing will come upon the Gentiles through faith in Christ Jesus. And he also mentioned towards the latter part of chapter 3 about the fact that we have been baptized into Christ, that we that have accepted the Lord Jesus, we are sons of God through faith in Christ Jesus. The Lord is our tutor, a schoolmaster to bring us to Christ. Now that Christ has come, we are no longer under the law, but now we are under Christ to be the very element of our being. By chapter 4, he now said that, look, that and here, as long as he remains a child, doesn't differ from a slave, though he be Lord over all. So the goal is that we should allow Christ, we should grow up spiritually. It was just a charge, an admonition that, hey, grow up, get away from drinking milk and start chewing meat. And he also further in chapter 4 talks about Abraham having two sons, the son of the bondwoman from Mount Sinai in Arabia, and also the son of the free woman, which is Isaac. That's Ishmael and Isaac. That these two are always at war, the old and the new, the flesh and the spirit, and the law and Christ. And by chapter 5, he said that we should stand fast in the liberty that Christ has made us. And he also talks about the fact that the work of the flesh which a lot of the work of the flesh that was listed there, and also the fruit of the Spirit, love, joy, peace, kindness, and the nine of them. And also by chapter 6, it now says that we should bear one another's burden, that way we fulfill the law of Christ, and we should always sow to the Spirit, and so that that God is not mocked. Whatever a man sow, he will reap. And if you sow to the flesh, you reap corruption. If you sow to the Spirit, you will reap life everlasting. And it says that we should bear one another's burden. And what a joy for what the Lord is doing. So the essence of it is that he said, I bear in my body the mark of the Lord Jesus Christ. Let no man trouble me. And he said, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with your spirit. Hallelujah to the all-inclusive Christ. Christ lives in me. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah.